Hi and welcome back, friends of a thoughtful gaming experience. I'm your host, Emmanuel Kahn, and we're going to proceed with our Let's Play and explore Torment, Tides of Numenera with our glaive. In the last episode we talked a lot to these small children and got some kind of quest from Lord Venkus to find the Stichus. Stichus is like digging holes around here, which makes the houses fall down. So, and the little girl Nim talks about Mittens the monster, which Zepp claims is her imaginary friend, but it might be the Stichus. So let's talk to this thing. Stichus, partially hidden in the treasure of the dump, a strange and frightened creature. It's covered in chitin like an insect, but its shell looks thin and soft, and its small and malformed claws seem half-grown. It stares at you from its hiding place and chitters incomprehensibly. What are you? The creature makes vague motions with its claws and emits a series of clicks and wet guttural noises. Oddly, you smell dust and lightning. Some of the sounds are reminiscent of a human with digestive trouble, but you're fairly certain it's some form of language. Are you the rogue Stichus that everyone's looking for? As you speak, you gesture in the direction of the square where you met Lord Wundgen. The Stichus seems to understand. It shrinks back, raising its deformed claws as if to defend itself. It doesn't seem like it would be much of a threat to anyone. It puffs a minuscule amount of vapor from the spike wreckles on its head. How did you get here? It weaves its head and clicks its claws, then pauses as if waiting for a response. The odor of ozone and stale air surrounds you. When you make no reply in its language, it shakes its head vigorously and says nothing more. Where are you from? A series of gurgling sounds emerges from deep inside its belly, punctuated by a concussive grunt, followed by a scent of sparks struck from rocks and metal. It isn't clear whether the Stichus understood you or not. Excuse me for a moment. Something about the creature's behavior is familiar, and you realize that you, or at least the changing god, have spoken to the beasts before. Not skillfully, but well enough to be understood. Try to remember the language of the sticker. It's too hard. No, we won't do that. Can you tell me anything about this place? Smell of coal, dust and rotting metal surrounds you. It takes you a moment to realize that the Stichus emitted the scent. Leave it alone. Yeah. Again, we need to find some way to rest. Oh, what's happened now? Zepp, a scrawny boy in rags, reaches out to you as you pass. Sir, please, sir. I know you saw the Stichus hiding in the midden. Please don't tell anyone about him, sir. He's not doing anyone any harm. I saw his hands. They're like human hands. He can't dig like the others. It's not him that's bringing down the houses. What is this Stichus to you? We found him, sir. My sisters and I. And he was so pitiful. Near to starving, near to dying. We've been feeding him old devices and power cells ever since. But we've got to get him out of here. The neighbors will find him soon, and then that will be the end of him. How were you planning on getting him out of here? I wish I knew, sir. We can't just walk him down the street or that fat little lord would see him. Not to mention the neighbors, and they'd kill him for sure. You feed him power cells? Sticker eat electrical energy. And we can't find nearly enough. He's starving. And what are the stickers? Everybody knows what sticker are. They're diggers. They make tunnels under the ground. People around here think they're the reason that the houses are falling down. Except this one can't dig, so the other ones kicked him out. At least I think that's what happened. Anyway, he's alone, like my sisters and I, so we want to help him. Sounds to me like Sticker are a danger to the city. But he's not, sir, I'm telling you. He can't dig. All he wants is to go somewhere safe. Maybe I can find a way to get him out of here. Could you, sir? That would be wonderful. If you can find the other Sticker, maybe they'd help him escape. I heard that some of them are down in the underbelly, but I've never seen them myself. All right, I'll try. It doesn't seem dangerous. Thank you, sir. Was there anything else?
No.
Farewell. There's a house. Let's go into that. Maybe that's a tavern. Finally. Ah, no, it's the underbelly again. Ah, should have known. Should have known. But anyway, let's look at again at this beautiful picture. What's there in the behind? Is there a robot? A robot smith? I'm not keen on going there when there's something flying around and this green kind of... Ooh. No, let's go back here. When you expend effort, you spend points from your might, speed, or intellect pool. Yeah, of course, and how do we get them back? Is there some kind of... What's that? Triangles. Flying triangles. These three triangles float serenely above a scuffed stone basin. You can't help noticing that the citizens of Sagas are giving this monument a wide berth. The largest triangle shines brightly, radiating a soothing warmth. The middle, darker one, who was above it, turns slightly away from the first with what strikes you as disdain. The third is small, dryly amused, so deeply indigo as to be nearly black. It's removed from the first two triangles. You hesitate. You are sensing emotions from these objects. Intent. Something is strange here. Let's look at the stone basin first. Stone is cracked in places, but far newer than the ancient shapes it contains. You suspect that the citizens of Sagas hoped the ring would make the triangles look less out of place. Alright, examine the smallest triangle. A tiny object appears to be spinning, but so quickly that you can't see the motion at all. Or perhaps the motion itself is the illusion. You pinch a corner of the triangle. The world whirls around you. You blink, swaying. In the half second before you open your eyes, you hear the thunderous crack of wood on wood and the rumble of distant voices. Snatch your hand from the triangle. Let's do this again. It hangs before you, both seeming to move, and clearly motionless. Try this again. Oh, alright, nothing new. Study the medium-sized one. Staring at this triangle is disorienting. You can't seem to look at it head-on, even though you're certain you've moved to face it. Instead, the face of the thing seems to be endlessly directed just to the right of your head and far away. You brush the triangle's icy face with your finger. The air thickens like a weight over you, and you struggle to keep your eyes open. Between the thumping of your heartbeat, you hear thousands of purposeful, rhythmic footsteps treading endless stairs toward the peak of a vast, echoing room. Study it again. It remains focused away from you, no matter how you try to look at it head on. Alright, to the large one. You reach out and time slows. Your hand drifts past individual motes of light-dappled dust, moving into the warm glow of the large triangle. Calm warmth bleeds up your arm when you grasp the edge of the triangle. It's somehow rigid and flexible at the same time. You blink and a strip of light unwinds ahead of you, like a path through infinite murmuring dark. Behind you is an ever-shifting soul trope of linked motionless hues. It's your past you realize, every second of it, every choice pouring out of you and trailing away into the black. You open your eyes. You're back at the stone ring, still touching the triangle. All three of them are watching you. You blink again. The strip of light, the surrounding darkness, and in the valley between the slow pulsing of your heart, you hear the murmurs of countless witnesses, the raised voices of your past and future companions, the heated condemnations of enemies you haven't met yet. And above it all, a trio of voices, one warm, one cold, and one dryly practical. They are speaking a verdict, but you can't hear them over the din. Shout for silence so you can hear the judges. Bellow into the dark, clenching your fists, and the crowd instantly falls silent. So do the judges. In the echoing silence that follows, you realize that you are alone. You always were. You stride on. The path unravels before you, your every step, your past unspools behind you. Stay on the path to see where it leads. You follow the road. Casually, you look to the right, and the path at your feet flickers, as if anticipating your new direction. Clearly, your choices define this road's course, and not the other way round. You open your eyes. The three triangles hang in the air, exactly as it did before, unmoving and silent. The vision is gone, and yet you can still feel the choices you've made, curving away behind you like a string of jewels. You straighten, moving into the future, breath by breath. You suddenly notice a message carved into the stone ring beneath the triangles. Judge yourself. As you watch, it slowly fades away. Step away. Things to think about. So many. Now let's talk to this guy here. Do you know more about the triangles? Aidan Sitabo. The large muscled man is practicing some form of martial arts as you look on. He's wearing an old, wild, rough woven coat with the sleeves torn off. The red bandana is wrapped tightly around his head. Seems to be moving much faster than his size suggests is possible. He glides between stances as swiftly as water. His fists are blurring, hammers striking at invisible enemies. His bare, calloused feet snap and slash at the air like knives. Where did you learn to fight like that? By challenging the deadliest creatures and studying their killing blows, he says. I lack claws or teeth, but I do the best I can. You're very fast. Yes, Aidan says. The Drebbel's gift. His hand slips around an invisible assailant's arm. He snaps it with a stab of his elbow, then crushes his enemy's throat and flips him over the shoulder to the ground. Yesantum Arai, he shouts, spinning over the invisible adversary's corpse to deliver a triangle of jabs to the chest of his next attacker. The entire set of moves took no longer than 4 seconds. He catches you staring and smiles. You must be wondering why I am shouting. Yeah, well, I did some karate, so I know, but the last cast of won't know. Yes. I am not surprised. I must look like a lunatic, he says, before sparing his opponent's jugular with 3 fingers. Conceit trust! Years ago, I was a starving beggar. I managed to steal a wedge of pie crust and was terrified that someone else would take it from me. So I hid inside that silver structure over there to enjoy my feast. Bite of the hidden queb, he says, clawing his enemy's eyes. Stale crust crumbled into pieces between my eager fingers. Something strange happened. They drifted toward the ground like the softest of snowflakes. I was able to pluck each of them from the air before they fell. First I was delighted, then I wept. How far had I fallen? That clean food was a miracle. He sighs, then delivers four more blows to the air's belly. But the miracle never ended. The longer I lived in that shelter, the more I could slow the world by concentrating. I swore to never waste this gift. I would honor it by becoming stronger, faster. I would challenge the predators of the world and take their killing blows from them. I would never be prey again. Grush, stomp. I bet I'm faster than you. I won't bet that with that stat pool. But I'm sure if we win that, then we'll have another and good companion. So let's come back to this guy. Who does the claw of the Lorik call now? Loss of self. Loss of self. This young woman clutches herself and growls low and continuously under her breath. Pearly white light shimmers for a while on her wrist, and her eyes are red-rimmed as if she's been crying. I've never seen her before, and yet your hands are sweating and your breath catches in your inherited chest. Shame burns your throat, hot and sour. Your body recognizes her, even if you do not. Leave me alone, she mutters. And it's a moment before you realize she's not talking to you. You took my face, stole my family. Whisper at me. In my own voice, isn't that enough? Isn't that... She breaks off when she sees you. She's in my head and she won't. Shut up. Talk loud. Talk over her. So I can hear you. What is that shining object you're holding? She flinches, but reveals the vial strapped to her wrist. It glows with an inner light, and the tiny ripples within seem to cast moving shadows on her palm. I woke up one night in a building I'd never seen before, she says, soft and low. I found this beneath a pile of blackened scales. If you shake it, it makes a picture. Watch. She jiggles the vial and holds up her other hand. Indistinct shadows mimic the motion of her palm. Why are you holding on to it? Because I feel like it was mine, she blurts, then grimaces as the words escaped without her permission. At any rate, it's mine now, and I don't need more of a reason than that. Why is that vial so important to you? Again, it's not that it's important, she says, frowning. I just feel better holding it, and there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not sure. Let me ask you something else. Good, she says with visible relief. You hear a woman in your head? Yes, she says, biting the word like an enemy's throat. Now stop talking about her. It brings her forward and she clings. She whines and she won't stop. So please stop talking about her. I'm sorry, but I want to hear about the woman in your head. No, every time I think about her, she inches closer to me, pulls on my arm. Stop asking about her, please. Alright. Goodbye then, I guess. Finson's Levy. Face of this armored man is oddly generic, almost as if it was designed to be forgettable. His livery marks him as a soldier in the service of Sager's Cliffs. A levy, the word comes easily to your mind. He stares past you, turning a small charred object over and over in his hands, whispering to himself. His oddly spaced eyes are red, wet, and haunted. Greetings, he says, apparently by reflex. Still hasn't looked your way. How can I help you? closes his eyes hard as if trying to crush visions that are troubling him. What's wrong with you? I am wrong, the levy agrees, his lip trembling, rotten, made of the wrong pieces, and tied together with blackened wire. He covers his face with his wrists. Please go. I need to talk to you about someone. Yes, he says, then shakes his head. No, I can't. Find another levy, please. Can I report crimes to you? Crime, he says, as if he's never heard the word. No, please, no. What are you holding there? I'm, he says, then grimaces as though his words hurt him. I'm holding my shame. His hands unfold one bloody, soot-covered finger at a time. Crudely made wooden bird lies there, painted in pinks and pale blues, and charred around the edges. That bird represents your shame? Represents? No, this is my shame, and I'm holding it. He swallows. I can't put it down. I need directions. I can't help you. I'm wrong. He pauses, lifting his eyes to the sky. I'm lost. You're lost? Yes, no, I know where I am. He squeezes his eyes shut. I know everywhere I've been. That's really strange. But then again, what's not strange here? This dilapidated structure has been converted into a cheap boarding house. Inside, people sprawl on filthy mattresses in a dimly lit room. Yeah, well, I would like to rest now. Come here. Ah, that is Finzen, belonging to the guard here. Oh, let's first look at this machine again. A silent angular machine casts a long shadow. As you study it, your breath stutters in your chest and your hands shake. You can't help feeling as though you have stood in this exact spot before. Try to remember why this machine... I know, we'll need points for that. Examine the device then instead. A jumble of different technologies make up this once functional generator. Once again, you notice the circuit symbol etched into the side like a maker's mark. Leave the generator alone. And I think before we talk to Finzen and perhaps make a quest here, we'll just say that this will conclude this session of Thoughtful Gaming. Thank you for watching. If you like the videos, you know what to do, and I'm happy that you like them. So happy gaming to you. See you in the next episode. This is Immanuel Can signing out.